کنفرانس در لاهه، مقر دادگاه بین المللی جنایی. فراخان به اعلام لیبرتی به عنوان کمپ پناهندگی. محکومیت جنایات خامنه ای مالکی علیه مجاهدین. 30 اکتبر 2012، 9 آبان 1391. دکتر خوان گارسه، پروفسور هانک دهان، پاتریک کندی، هری فان بومل نماینده پارلمان هلند، بیوک بومر نماینده پیشین پارلمان اروپا و سرهنگ وسلی مارتین.
Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the Dutch friends over Free Iran, I welcome you warmly in this International Press Center Nieuwspoort. And a special word of welcome, of course, to our very distinguished guest, Patrick Kennedy, General Wesley Martin, and our lawyer, Mr. Garces, Juan Garces. Our two American friends had very big difficulties to reach The Hague of the tornadoes and the orcans. In the United States, they came somewhat earlier, and but also a special welcome to Mr. Garces. It's from Spain. That's 2 or 3 hours by airplane. The reason that we are here, that's in the first place, of course, that we all have enormous sorrows about our friends in Liberty Camp. That's one of the reasons that we organized here this meeting, to ask the attention of our political friends here in the Netherlands, but also in Europe, to have an active position to save the lives of the people in Liberty Camp. Liberty Camp is not a refugee camp, it is a jail, it is a prison. That is the actual situation. And that is a very important point to set that under the political agenda here in Europe. That's a very concrete point. The second point is, of course, that the situation in Iran, that it is miserable, you know that, of course. If you don't know the situation in Iran, you are crazy, in my view. Everybody agrees, of course, that the situation in Iran is deteriorating. And in my view, and also in the view of my old friends in Europe, like Lord Slynn of Hadley, he doesn't live. That's a pity, of course. He said once, I say, Hank, you are a member of parliament. Yeah, I was a member of parliament. He said, because you are a member of parliament in a democracy, human rights is your core business, Hank. Irrespective whether you are left-wing or right-wing. That's why the third point is, of course, that is very happy, of course. We have to celebrate something because the United States will survive after a lot of work done by Patrick Kennedy and so on, that the POI is deleted from the list of terrorists. I wish you a very pleasant evening. I give the floor to our good old friend, Patrick Kennedy.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Viva Ashraf! Viva Ashraf! Viva Liberty! Viva Ashraf! Viva Ashraf! Viva Ashraf! Viva Ashraf! Viva Ashraf! Viva Ashraf! Thank you very much. And thank you to our hosts. And let me say what an honor it is for me to be in this capital, The Hague. For those around the world, the word Hague means the court of final justice. The International War Crimes Tribunal is here in this city. How appropriate it is then that we gather here this evening to talk about an issue of international justice, because this is a city dedicated to international justice. As my good friend said, what brings us to this cause is the cause of human rights. And that is a cause that unites all of us. But because you see, the cause of human rights is a universal cause. That's why we have an international court on human rights. Because in the words of Dr. Martin Luther King, a threat to justice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. So we are not here tonight simply because we want to see freedom in a country called Iran, in a country called Syria, in countries across the world. We are here because freedom is being threatened, and it's being threatened by the largest state sponsor of terrorism in the world, Iran, who has systematically perpetrated human rights abuses against their own people in Iran, as well as people throughout the Middle East and throughout the world. So tonight we talk about the fight for justice for the people in Camp Ashraf, now in Camp Liberty. But the reason we fight for the people in Camp Liberty and those remaining in Ashraf is because they are fighting on the front lines to find a new Iran. And now we know that the United States is joining the rest of the world in finally acknowledging that the main opposition group, the most organized, well-financed opposition group to the mullahs in Tehran, is the MEK, who is fighting to see a change and bring about freedom in Iran. But there are many who attack the MEK. My father, Senator Edward M. Kennedy, when he was in the Senate, he stood with a man named Nelson Mandela. Back then, Nelson Mandela was called a terrorist. Imagine a man of such stature and peace in the world as Nelson Mandela being labeled a terrorist. For what? Because he wanted a free South Africa where everybody could enjoy the blessings of freedom. And yet he was labeled, not only in South Africa by the apartheid government, he was labeled in the United States of America as a terrorist, until my father fought to see the United States policy change, where instead of being on the side of those who had oppressed people, the United States took the side of Nelson Mandela and a new South Africa. And tonight, we need to do the same in Iran and support the MEK. And this, as my good friend said, is not an issue of the left or the right, because in the United States, we joined a campaign to delist the MEK that was made up of Democrats and Republicans and former military officials who joined together and said, this, we must be on the side of those who want freedom and democracy in Iran. And those people are the people that have been fighting for a free Iran, the MEK. And that is why we need to make sure they get delisted. But as you know, that fight has been a long fight. And it has been fought most particularly in Camp Ashraf and Liberty. But we have managed in the United States to finally delist this terror label off the MEK. And finally, the people in Camp Ashraf and now in Liberty need to be recognized by the United Nations and the United States as the refugees that they are and treated with dignity and respect and human rights, because that's what they deserve. But we are here tonight, and you are going to hear from Colonel Martin, who will tell you how right now the United Nations and the United States still make it impossible for the people of Camp Liberty to live free and safe. They are a refugee camp treated like a concentration camp. They are living in intolerable situation, being denied their medications, denied access for those who are physically disabled, denied water and electricity in some cases. So tonight we want a message to go out here in The Hague that we expect the United Nations to uphold its charter to protect the people of Camp Liberty and make sure they are afforded all the human dignity that they deserve as asylum seekers. So we are going to send a message to Nouri al-Maliki to back off and make sure that you know that if you don't do the right thing, someday, thanks to those in Spain who have issued the war crimes indictment on Nouri al-Maliki for his attacks on Ashraf, we might bring you, Nouri al-Maliki, right here to The Hague and try you for war crimes tribunals. We want the people of liberty to be living safe and afforded human rights and dignity. Now, who can argue that people who have been fighting the mullahs in Tehran deserve protection from the rest of Europe and the rest of the world? When Tehran has been the single largest state sponsor of terrorism, we all want them to be able to go back to Iran, but not an Iran that's led by the mullahs, not an Iran that's destined to try to build a nuclear weapon. We want an Iran with the rest of the world community dedicated to the civilized world, a democracy in Iran. And that day, my friends, is coming, and it is coming soon because of the sacrifice of all of you. We have seen in Iran the international sanctions finally take hold, because these sanctions are not just United States sanctions. They're European sanctions, they're international sanctions. And my friends, I believe that that day is coming soon, because the days of the mullahs are numbered. They have taken the wrong side of history on every score, and now they're siding with Bashar al-Assad in Syria, and they know that their days are numbered in Syria, and ultimately the focus of the international community is going to come back to where it started in Tehran, and there's going to be nowhere for them to go. Thank you very, very, very much.
Professor Dehan, President of Dutch Group of Friends of Free Iran, Mr. Van Bommel, Mr. Peter Omtzigt, Mr. Boehmer, and other Dutch parliamentarians and personalities, Congressman Patrick Kennedy, Colonel Martin, and Mr. Juan Garce. Dear Syrian friends and brothers, ladies and gentlemen, allow me to express my appreciation to the distinguished members of the panel for your attention to Iran's issue and your support for the Iranian resistance for freedom and democracy. Over the past three decades, one could hardly find a period in which Iran's situation has been so critical. Economic collapse with 50% inflation, 30% unemployment, and 75% drop in the value of Iran's currency. Internal feuding within the ruling circles, pressure derived from social discontent, and the likely overthrow of the Syrian regime, the most important strategic ally of the Iranian regime. All indications are that Iran is ready for change. Circumstances, removal of Iran's largest organized opposition from the US terror list is in the right direction for a genuine solution. An Iranian solution based on the great potential of the Iranian society for change. This solution is overthrow of the religious dictatorship by the Iranian people and their resistance. This development has, on one hand, prompted the Iranian society and particularly the youth to see the weakness of the mullahs as well as the advancement of the resistance And on the other hand, it has made the mullahs more fearful for their future. Revocating of this designation is not only an indication of the legitimacy of the resistance movement. It is not only a sign of the falsity of the allegations against the resistance movement, but also it speaks for the capability of this movement. Capability in winning a large and complicated legal and political battle. Capability in crushing the huge misinformation campaign of the mullahs and their allies who advocate the policy of appeasement. Capability in forming an international political front in defense of freedom and democracy in Iran. Evidently, this victory is owed to the perseverance and sacrifices made by members of the resistance, unsparing backing of the Iranian people and solidarity of the honorable and respectable personalities like you throughout the world. This movement plays the key role in future developments in Iran. It holds the key to the problem of Iran and is the response to the essential demand of the Iranian society for change. This movement is based on pluralism, separation of church and state, gender equality, and a non-nuclear Iran. Therefore, those who benefit from Iran's current regime remaining in power do not hide their fears of the removal of the PMI from terror list. They aggressively attack this movement. Following the removal of the PMI from terror list, the demonizing campaign against the resistance has enormously intensified. They try to distort the image of the resistance by ridiculous label like being a cult or not having social roots in Iran. The 2011 annual report of the Netherlands Internal Intelligence and Security once again stated that in 2011, the AIVD has observed that the Iranian Ministry of Intelligence and Security is constantly active in lobbying against the Iranian opposition movement, the PMOI, in Netherlands. The Iranian Intelligence Service is providing management and financing for the efforts that are aimed at demonizing the PMOI both in the media and among the politicians. What's the truth? The argument is not about being a cult or the extent of the resistance's popular support. The truth is that today or in the future, no solution will bear fruit without the key role of the Iranian resistance. Advocates of the appeasement attack the democratic alternative to the regime in order to help the regime remain in power. International sanctions are essential, but not enough. The key factor for change is the Iranian resistance. Therefore, only a policy which combines the sanctions with support for the Iranian opposition will seriously harm the regime. What has blocked the situation in Syria is the extensive meddling of the mullah's regime. And what can stop the mullahs is also the Iranian resistance, which seeks democratic change in Iran. For many years, West has ignored the movement, which is capable of organizing the huge potentials of the Iranian society for change. following the PMI delisting. In the US, all other remaining obstacles should also be removed to open the path for Iranian resistance. Dear friends, I would also take the opportunity to underscore the necessity for active intervention of the United States and the European Union with regards to the situation of members of opposition in Ashraf and Liberty. Their current situation in which they are deprived of humanitarian and human rights standards is the result of Western powers' appeasement of the religious fascism ruling Iran and its puppet government in Iraq. With their silence and inaction, they have practically allowed the mullahs' suppression and crimes against members of the opposition to continue. Therefore, Liberty residents are at present deprived of their minimum legal rights, despite the fact that they are protected persons under the Fourth Geneva Convention and have been recognized as asylum seekers and people of concerns by the UNHCR. Unfortunately, the United Nations has not fulfilled its legal obligations towards the residents either. More regretful is that in practice, the special representative of the UN Secretary General also stands on the side of the Iraqi government. I call on the United States and the EU member states, such as the Dutch government, to compel the Iraqi government to stop breaching legal and human rights of the Liberty and Ashraf residents, and to urge the UN to announce Camp Liberty as a refugee camp in order to facilitate the residents' resettlement. Once again, I thank you all.